Welcome to the Hay Kings podcast, brought to you by Crone, dedicated to hay and forage producers. Today on the podcast, I'm joined by Nathan Beus and David Cannon. Nathan is an agent and broker and co-owner at Sloan Levitt Insurance, and David is an agent. Nathan is a farm guy to start with, and has, in fact, milked cows by hand, and not just like once at a fair. You did this.
Every day. Every day growing up, except when the cow was dried up and we had a little break.
Yep. I just wanted to say that to emphasize that these folks really do understand agriculture. If you've milked a cow by hand and the first thing you say it was every day, and worse yet, my younger siblings didn't have to do it, and I'm upset.
My four younger brothers never did it.
You see, I
hope they hear this.
From one recovering dairyman to another, I deeply appreciate that. As we think about farm business management, which is one of my things, we need to talk about insurance. So I reached out to these folks, and I've met David on several occasions, and I look forward to meeting Nathan along the way, to talk about property and casualty insurance. But they also sell crop insurance, and we can talk a little bit about the crop insurance side, but we're going to save the forage crop insurance discussion for another episode. Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good to be here.
One of the things I want to start with is the way that producers interact with insurance companies. And one of the things that I tell the producers that I work with all the time is to have an asset list and to update it. Like, updating that asset list is really, really important for lots of reasons, for the bankers, for your own understanding, but also for insurance. What do we need to know from your perspective?
It's super important on our side when you're talking about, you know, property insurance, that we know what we're insuring, that the insurance company has an understanding of what they're insuring. So you know, having an accurate list of equipment that they're insuring, and you know, if you sell a tractor and that tractor was listed on the policy, but you never tell anybody that it's gone, you'll continue to pay premium for that tractor, that there's no exposure. And on the other side, if you go out and buy a new tractor or a new baler and never add it on to your policy, never tell your agent about it, there's potentially no coverage for that if it's in an accident or in a fire. So it's critical to try to keep that up to date.
Really, that can be as simple as an Excel spreadsheet with the items listed, the make, the model, the serial number, the purchase price. Is there anything else that we're missing?
So those are the main things. I mean, one big consideration is that there's a couple different ways to insure equipment, especially equipment, either on a scheduled basis where you have a list of things and they're covered. Each item is individually covered with its own limit of insurance, or on a blanket basis where you say, I've got $3 million worth of equipment out there, and the insurance, you know, on your policy, it just has unscheduled farm personal property for $3 million. That typically that costs a little bit more money to insure it that way. It has a higher rate, but obviously the advantage is you've got coverage even if you haven't adequately kept it up to date. So a lot of times we'll tell growers, if you just have three pieces of equipment that you care to insure, then let's just schedule them, because it's really easy to keep track of three pieces of equipment. And if you have 50,
maybe a different story.
Yeah, doing it on a blanket, because you can't just sit down and in 5 minutes look at the list and be confident that you're accurate.
Okay, one of the things you mentioned in there was setting limits. Take me through that process.
Equipment limits is you really want to make sure that if you ever have a claim that you're getting paid what it costs you to replace that equipment. My background was I was a claims adjuster, and the way that equipment is generally valued on an actual cash value basis is that we would look at the market, current market value for the specific piece of equipment you have, and then we'd make adjustments based on the number of hours that the equipment had or any any additional accessories you might have on that equipment. Mm-hmm. And something that's quite often forgot in that equipment valuation is to make sure you include sales tax or delivery fees. Some issues that I've seen is sometimes you'll buy equipment at a discount. You'll buy five or six pieces. The dealer will give you a good discount when you buy those pieces. You'll go to your agent. You'll tell your agent what the price was that you paid on those pieces rather than the price if you had to replace it as a single item. And then you have a fire or a catastrophic loss, and sometimes you just end up underinsured. Other things to just note is sometimes the value of equipment goes up. We've seen economic issues that have caused equipment prices to go up by 10, 15, 20% in a year. Mm-hmm. And when they go up, if you don't increase that policy limit, you can find yourself underinsured.
As I'm listing out the pieces of equipment that I have, if we're doing a scheduled basis, producers should still have a list of everything, period, end of story, insurance or not, to include the purchase price and break out the sales tax and the delivery and just have that in different columns. And then include if there was a discount on there. I think that's something that I'm going to be adding to my spiel.
That's a good idea. And it used to be that you could kind of, equipment always went down, right? It always depreciated consistently.
Not necessarily.
And so you could kind of save. I mean, yeah, we've seen it in the last 5 years. Equipment's gone up, and so before you could go, well, I paid $100,000. If I just set it there, it'll be fine. Mm-hmm. I'll have enough insurance. And yeah, now you might need to revisit some of that.
Nathan was going to chat about appropriate limits on buildings and commodities.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, on the building side, most farmers, you can also schedule or you can blanket buildings, theoretically. It's very uncommon on just kind of family farms to have a blanket on farm buildings. So you're going to have each building scheduled separately. You can value them either on a replacement cost basis, which is what would it cost to rebuild with like kind and quality, you know, materials, this building that I have here. Or you can do it on an actual cash value basis, which is replacement cost minus depreciation. So if the building though that you need and it's part of your operation, you're probably going to want to ensure that you use replacement cost. Mm-hmm. And that can be a challenge to come up with that. To come up with that figure, there are computer programs out there that we use to try to calculate that. Insurance companies will, year after year, they will apply inflation factors, 4% or 6%. And in recent years, we've seen 10 and 12% to try to keep up with that. But I think it's important for insureds to, fairly regularly just look and see if the numbers that they have on their the values that the limits on their policies are realistic and, appear up to date.
Let's take a break there and we'll get a word from our sponsor.
What's the big deal? Right now, get 0.9% interest on Krohn Big M mower conditioners and Krohn Big X forage harvesters. With 36-month terms on Big X and 60 months on Big M, that equates to years of savings on the Krohn equipment you need. Plus, get extended warranties on both the Big M and Big X, 3 years or 2,400 hours. Big performance, big throughput, big comfort. Go big, go Krohn. Special financing ends November 30th. See your Krohn dealer today.
Let's have a discussion on risk management philosophy. We've talked a little bit about being underinsured. Is there such thing as overinsured? Why might that be the case? How does a hay producer set a risk management philosophy?
There are a lot of things that the insurance companies are looking at when they're determining rate. And we, as the agent, when we're doing the application process, we're probably asking a bunch of questions that the customer don't always understand why we're asking them or what the effect is. We'll ask questions, when was the last time your roof was replaced or your plumbing updated or electrical updated? We'll ask about whether you run MVRs on your drivers before they are able to drive company vehicles. We ask about maintenance programs on vehicles. And then when we compile all that information on the applications that go into the carriers, each one of those factors is a consideration that affects your rate positively or negatively. Mm-hmm. There are some big ones that come up recently that are kind of hot topics. One is having defensive space in wildfire areas. And we are seeing more and more companies that they pull up these fire maps, they look and see if you've had a wildfire in your area in the last few years. And then if they see that there's been a wildfire area, they're asking, how many feet of distance is there? What's the structure made of? Are we using combustible materials, non-combustible materials on the house? Do we have haystacks or debris that could catch fire?
Right.
Nathan, what else have you seen?
Well, yeah, those I agree with all of that. I mean, taking a step back and thinking about the bigger picture. Different growers, different insureds, all of us individually will have different risk tolerance levels.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you have $1 million in the bank, you might look differently at what deductibles you're willing to take. Mm-hmm. for your, what's a catastrophic loss to you is going to be different than somebody that does not have that cash in the bank. So we all kind of approach it differently. When you're buying insurance, you're transferring that risk. You don't want to retain yourself, and you're transferring that to the insurance company, and you're paying that premium. But there are other ways to manage that risk.
Mm-hmm.
And over time, the only way as a whole that we can bring down those costs are to have fewer claims and do a lot of the things that David's talking about to over time reduce the number, the frequency, and the severity of the losses that we have, so that an insurance company is willing to take that risk from you for less premium because they view you as a more favorable risk, right? So anyway, that's kind of philosophically, that's
mm-hmm.
kind of how I'm looking at that. And then the growers are making decisions. How high of a deductible am I willing to take? Do I need to insure all of this equipment? Do I need full coverage on my autos? How high of a liability limit do I need? Am I okay with just $1 million, or do I need a $10 million excess policy because I'm afraid of, getting sued, or even more?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So and those are considerations that, as David and I are out speaking with insureds, I mean, everybody's viewing those things differently and according to their own circumstances.
I have a question on, of course, we've been planning this a little bit, and there's a note here talking about keeping the farm clean. Why does that matter?
Almost every policy we write, we have a company that their underwriter is asking us for photos of the property.
Mm-hmm.
And they are likely to even follow that up with having an inspector come out and review the exterior of the property. When that underwriter is looking at that photo, they have some underwriting discretion. Like, are they going to mark that this is a well-kept property or a poorly kept property? It's fairly superficial. It's based on, a lot on their opinion and what they can see in the photo.
Mm-hmm.
But that's going to be a consideration that's going to affect whether we can write the policy with that carrier and some degree what the rate's going to be. And so just having it clean and looking nice is going to be to your advantage.
So this goes back to the 5 C's of credit that I'm familiar with, having worked at a bank. We talk about the first one is character. That almost feels like you're analyzing the insured's character. Kind of subjectively looking at, not in the case of traditional 5 C's of credit where your character is your credit score, but rather maybe from a more commercial lender where the lender comes out and meets with you, looks at your operation, sees what you have going on. How does it look? That concept applies just the same in insurance then.
Yeah, it definitely does. And from our standpoint, you know, if somebody calls and says, hey, I've had a big claim or claims and my insurance company's dropping me. And maybe I'm coming out there trying to find them a new insurer. Mm-hmm. It makes it a lot easier if I can tell the underwriters at various other companies, look at how clean and look how they've parked their equipment all in a nice row. They clearly are showing pride of ownership. Obviously, if they're paying attention to details here, they're paying attention to details in other aspects of mm-hmm. their operation that are less visible. And so, yes, maybe they had this claim, this loss, something happened, but you know, losses can happen to anybody.
Yep.
And so if you can show that the losses that they've had are not predictive of future losses, but that they're, look at these other things that they're doing mm-hmm. in their operation that are more predictive of a good future, then you can win over underwriters that way. And legitimately so. I think any of us, I mean, it's not like underwriters are some strange species of people. I think we're all that way. We all are influenced that way,
right.
You know?
Right.
So yeah, definitely. And maybe it does speak to character or maybe just to the, you know, the willingness of somebody at the end of the day to pay attention to some of those details, to keep the weeds down, to, you know, not have a big junk pile that could catch fire, mm-hmm. right. Or promote the spread of a fire. So yeah, definitely. Those are really important things.
Somebody that has clean equipment that's all parked in a line probably has their fire extinguishers serviced or checked or replaced or updated. Like it's those kind of relationships that you're talking about that would make a financial
Absolutely.
Difference. Okay.
You know, and their employees, the other thing is their workers probably know that paying attention to details like that is important to this, to their boss.
Mm-hmm.
And that the only getting it done fast isn't the only consideration. Obviously,
yes.
that my boss cares about these other things too.
100%. Yep. You might not like working for me in some conditions. The hay has to be raked perfectly.
Right. Yeah.
Perfectly. Every single freaking time.
When people drive by my farm, I want them to go, I want it to look good, be proud of it. Definitely.
Yep, absolutely. Let's talk about some of the unique things about insuring hay, because it's flammable. It's not like milk and eggs and apples. Hay has some unique issues.
Definitely.
And I want to tell one of my stories. I actually do read my insurance policy, but I'll admit that out of a couple hundred pages, I only made it to page 87, because on page 87, it said that I had stack limits for my haystacks. And that stack limit, mm-hmm. I'm now told, I knew it was too low, was $10,000 per stack. And each stack had to be separated by, I think it was 200 feet or 250 feet or some physical distance.
It may have been 100, likely 100. 100 is pretty common.
Pretty normal. Okay. But $10,000, even just using 200, that's only 50 tons in a stack. I don't just do 50 tons at a time in a stack. So I knew that I was going to be underinsured, and I had a conversation with my insurance agent about that, and he came up with some answers for me. They were relatively expensive answers, but they were answers. So take me through this process. Stack limits.
Go ahead, Nathan.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Every policy that insures hay will have some kind of stack limit on it. I shouldn't say every policy, but for the most part, they're all going to have a stack limit. So the policy will say you've got, they'll give you a dollar amount for the total amount of your hay, and then they'll have a limit per stack. And you're right, it's usually 100 feet of space. So if you have two stacks to us,
mm-hmm.
but if they're only 50 feet apart, to the insurance policy, that's one stack.
Right.
And so that's all going to be subject to the stack limit. So when we're talking to growers about this, that's what we're asking them, what's the biggest stack you have? And we need to set the stack limit at least that high. Mm-hmm. Now, you can usually get insurance companies, I'm talking in broad terms here, you know, if you want to go to 200 or 250,000, you can usually get them up that high. Mm-hmm. Above that, it gets to be trickier and more difficult. And, you know, of course, today with hay being worth less than what it was 2 years ago, it's easier to get that than the problem when hay was sky high, people were going, I don't even have enough stack yard space I can't make my stacks that small, you know, so that was, right. It was a more difficult conversation.
We're talking about dollar values of stacks. So if hay's at 300,
we're not talking about tonnage.
If hay's at $300 a ton, on my $10,000 example, well, then that's only 33 mm-hmm. tons in a stack instead of 50. And then you start spacing 33 ton stacks out every 100 feet. Oh, I could see how somebody could run out of a stack yard.
Yeah, exactly. Now, the way the policies typically work is they don't say if your stack exceeds. So if your stack limit is 200,000 and you have 250,000, the policy stops paying at 200. It doesn't say, sorry, that's ineligible. You have no coverage.
Right.
That's a common question that comes up. I mean, when you're talking about insuring hay, I think cotton has the same issue, you know, down in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
That's the biggest consideration. And of course, it's figuring out how you can stack your hay in such a way that in the most efficient way to minimize your costs, because you definitely pay more, like you said, John Paul, to have a higher stack limit.
Yep.
But also to still be covered, because a $10,000 stack limit, that's just not. And most policies will have that in there, and then at a later point in the policy, they'll have it expanded. You know, I guess one of the problems with insurance policies, if you only get to page 84, whatever page you were on,
you might have missed
later on where it said, hey, really, your stack limit's 100,000.
Oh, right.
Because we have this enhancement endorsement on the policy.
Yep. And that may be where we ended up. I just said, good grief. I can't do 30 ton stacks. That's silly. No. The answer is no.
I mean, that was written about 1970 when stacks really were only worth $10,000.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you're talking about, you know, $50 hay, then 200 tons. 200 tons is a reasonable stack. That's big for most people. Let's take a break there and we'll get a word from our sponsor.
What's up, hey Kings? You have a lot of choices when it comes to sourcing your equipment parts, but have you tried Messix? We have $20 million in equipment parts on our shelves, and we pick up from CNH Parts Depots daily. All this inventory is available with same-day shipping with no upcharges or expediting fees. Messix.com has exclusive features like transparent pricing, photos of parts, fit verification, alternative part options, and an obsolete part search tool alongside the manufacturer's drawing, so you're not guessing at what you need. We cover all the top brands, including New Holland, Case IH, Kubota, Krone, and Peckway, and more, all from our website. Our online tools are backed by 60-plus parts professionals who are just a call away, ready to find even the most obscure parts. So whether you're a seasoned farmer or a weekend enthusiast, think Messix for a convenient and professional part shopping experience. Visit us at Messix.com or call our parts hotline at 877-260-3528.
Messix, a helping hand with your land.
Is there a difference between hay stacked outside and hay stacked inside a barn?
Not really. Most of the carriers are considering it a stack as a stack.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess understanding stack limits and why they're there is an important part of, I guess, appreciating what the insurance companies are trying to do.
Yep.
Underwriters look at hay and they say, we'll throw a number out there. They say 1 in 1,000 bales are going to catch fire.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
oh, I hope not.
The difference, but let's say that's the number that they put out there.
Yep.
So, I mean, just for easy math. So where they say 1 in 1,000 bales are going to catch fire. And then they say the difference between the people we're insuring having stacks of 200 bales or 100 bales is that when this bale catches fire, we're not putting the fire out. Most of our stacks of hay don't have fire suppression capabilities close by.
Correct.
We're going to lose the whole stack.
Yep.
So they say if if this one bale that we insure catches fire, is it going to be a 100 bale loss or is it going to be a 200 bale loss?
Yep.
So they're just saying, hey, we want to partner with you. We want to insure your hay, but we're only willing to accept the risk under the assumption that you're going to help us limit how big this claim gets. Remember, the grower has a deductible. Mm-hmm. So it's $1,000 or $2,500 or whatever you pick as your deductible,
yep.
No matter how big your stack is. And everything else would fall on the insurance company unless there's a limit somewhere. And you don't want someone putting their, you know, $1 million worth of hay in a stack and then having that $1 million loss when you could have separated it into $100,000 or $200,000 set, you know, losses.
Mm-hmm. One correction: there is sometimes a difference between hay in the open versus hay in buildings, and you'd want to look at your individual policies, but there are policies where the hay in buildings is not subject to a stack limit. Now, a lot of times you can't fit that, you know, you can only put so much hay in that building.
Yeah, there's very few people that can put 1,000 tons in a barn, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah. So, but there can be a difference there. And a lot of times, there are policies where you'll have two lines, hay in the open and hay in buildings as two separate items on your policy. Mm-hmm. And they may even have different rates. You know, mm-hmm. sometimes hay in buildings is less expensive than hay in barns. And then the other thing that I would say, just kind of tongue in cheek, I don't know that insurance companies want to insure anybody's hay, but they're willing to do it.
Right.
It's kind of like, if we have to, I guess we want to insure farms. We're going to have to have something for the hay. But they're not overly excited about it.
There is a mathematical amount of money that they are willing to charge.
Yes.
But they're not out there competing for homeowners insurance. It's not the same.
Yeah, they're not. I mean, you don't see a lot of ads for hay insurance during the Super Bowl, right?
Not a single one. Nope.
Yeah.
Let's talk about hay press operations for a second. That's a very unique business, kind of unique to the West Coast, but there's definitely hay presses all over the U.S. So, and becoming more common in other areas. Let's talk about some of those special considerations.
Yeah, hay presses, man. In the last 4 or 5 years, the insurance market in general has been very hard. Premiums mm-hmm. Rates have been going up. Availability of reinsurance has been decreasing. And it's been really hard on hay presses. Mm-hmm. We could call any one of our just standard farm companies that used to do hay presses, and every one of them will tell us no today. They say, yeah, we got out of that. So the kind of the unique challenges that they have, one, they've got huge concentrations of values of hay.
Yep.
You know, where a farmer can figure out how to get his stacks down to 150 or 200,000.
Yep.
You know, you go drive by one of these hay presses and they can't make their stacks that small. So you have insurance companies not excited about that. You have a bottleneck going, you know, all this hay has to go through this press.
Yep.
So if you lose that press, you've got a very large business interruption loss.
Yep.
Right. Where, okay, now we can't press our hay. So you've got that. Those things are, you know, they tend to be worth just the press itself, what, $2 or $3 million.
Yep.
And it's housed inside of a barn that's probably worth $1.5 million, and they may or may not be storing seven figures worth of hay in very close proximity to that. So you just have this very high catastrophic, high severity mm-hmm. risk.
Yep.
And insurance companies have been shying away. So we're seeing them require much higher deductibles. We're seeing insurance companies on the hay want to exclude or limit spontaneous combustion as a cause of loss, which I mean, philosophically, I think is such a bad idea because you're just setting yourself up for a lawsuit, right? I mean, who's to say? A lot of times you don't know for sure how a fire started, right?
I mean,
and now
we have documented cases of spontaneous combustion and we have documented cases of arson. Those are both real world outcomes. Yep.
They're real things. So you have a $2 million fire and you have a insurance company saying, we got to figure out how to make this thing spontaneous combustion. And you have an insured saying, no matter what, we have to show that this wasn't spontaneous combustion. It just feels like you're setting yourself up for problems. But that, I mean, that's been a real, we're seeing that. Or they'll sublimit it. They'll say, we'll pay $2 million for any one fire, but $500,000 if it was caused by spontaneous combustion. So that's a big consideration. You know, just besides the availability of coverage that's unique to hay presses that we're not seeing anywhere else in the market right now.
From a hay grower's perspective, that gives the hay presses the incentive to hold that inventory out on the farm as long as possible. And maybe
absolutely
that takes us right to hay under contract. If I have sold this hay on contract to an export press or even a domestic press, but it's still in my possession, and in the contract with the exporter, we have an agreement saying that I will purchase the insurance for the hay. There's a reason for that, right?
Absolutely. Yes. My advice, if I was sitting in front of a hay press, that's exactly what I would tell them. I would say, put it in your contract. If you need to address the price, you know, maybe if you need to pay a little bit more for that, fine. But keep the insurance on the hay at the level of the farm, where it's very easy for a farmer to insure some additional hay.
Right.
And it's very difficult for the press. And the insurance company that's insuring the press, their argument, and it's a fair argument, is the farmer still has control of the conditions around that hay. And yep. So we can't, how do we underwrite that? How can we ask the press, well, what are you doing to mitigate your risk over here? And the press is going, I don't know. It's just that the farmer's place, we don't have control there. Right. So, but it should be in the contract, because the problem is if the press has already bought it, which they're probably not putting down deposits on hay like they used to a few years ago, but if they are and they've already paid for it, if it's not in the contract, you could potentially have a problem if that hay burns up and there was no contractual requirement.
Yep.
The farmer's insurance company might say, well, that wasn't even your hay. You haven't suffered a loss.
Right.
So you need that contract to establish an insurable interest.
Yep.
For the farmer to be able to insure it.
It's because the press has a very high cost to insure hay, where the farmer has a relatively low cost to insure hay.
Yes.
Are we talking about 2x, 3x the cost at a press?
I'd have to look at some numbers, but yeah, it could be that high. And then the other side of that is the press likely has a $50,000 or $75,000 or $100,000 or $250,000 deductible.
Oh, yeah.
And so that farmer, he may only have $100,000 sitting in the stack.
Yeah.
Even if the press is insuring it, it's just not going to respond.
Right. The insurance wouldn't even kick in.
The press policy is set up to insure the press policy is set up to insure this huge volume at one location where that high of a deductible makes sense.
Yep. I mean, that provides a why to the what of some of the contracts that we're seeing in the marketplace. Let's go over to custom operations, because on my farm, the neighbor calls and says, hey, I need somebody to bale this hay. And I go, well, my baler's sitting there not doing anything. Of course, I'm going to go bale your hay and make some money. But there's problems with that.
There are. The insurance companies, they give some of the lowest liability premiums to farmers.
Mm-hmm.
There's just not a lot that you're out doing that's going to cause injury to someone else. And you got 1,000 acres of stuff growing.
Yep.
But as soon as you leave the farm, now you have a piece of equipment that's traveling on roads or on someone's farm. They have their buildings, their infrastructure.
Yep.
Potential that you damage something there. It wasn't even a consideration or a potential on your own farm.
Mm-hmm.
So they just see that as a lot higher risk. When most companies have a threshold, so that, you know, if 10% of your income is custom cutting the neighbor's 5 acres, that they're not going to really raise an issue.
Yep.
But if you get up to the 15, 20, 30, and now you're growing, more and more companies are going to raise an issue with that custom cutting operation.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to make sure that you're letting them know that you're doing that you're taking the safety precautions you need to.
Mm-hmm.
In claims, we would pay for claims all the time where there might be a wellhead out in a hayfield, and you know, a little marker is missing, and the guy with the swather comes along and clips the wellhead, or they take out there's just so much infrastructure on someone else's farm, and then you're paying for the, you know, the repairs on the equipment that the custom cutter has. And,
yep.
And so they're going to charge a higher premium. And some companies are going to say, we're not going to insure you as a farmer if you're making X percentage of your income doing custom operations.
Right.
And so that's something to know. If you're going to do a lot of custom work, you might need to open a separate business that just does that custom work and insure it under its own name. So that's just something to make sure that your agent knows and is aware of, and that you're monitoring. Because there is a different expectation on what that insurance is going to look like.
Let's take a break there, and we'll get a word from our sponsor.
Get big and get better with special financing from Krohn. Now you can get 0.9% interest for 60 months on Krohn Big Pack Square Balers. That's years of savings at less than 1% interest. Plus, get 2 free pallets of Krohn Excellent Twine with every Krohn Big Pack. Get the bale size, density, and reliability that comes with every Krohn Big Pack Large Square Baler. Go big, go Krohn. Special financing ends November 30th. See your Krohn dealer today.
You just brought up like one of my biggest nightmares. Hitting a wellhead at 10 miles an hour or 15 miles an hour with a swather, it is actually pretty catastrophic. I mean, that's on the verge of new swather header kind of damage. And then the other things that come to mind, on my farms, we harrow everything in the spring. Everything's marked. I know where the wellhead, I actually don't think I have any wellheads in the middle of a field. There's a couple on the edges, but nothing in the middle. But what I do worry about is somebody's tire coming off their car, rolling out 100 yards into the middle of the field in chest high grass, eating a tire in the swather, or not catching a rock that goes into the baler. There's some considerations there too that's unique to the hay industry. Maybe not. Maybe if you're running a combine, a rock is fairly catastrophic too.
And that gets right down to your foreign objects and machinery.
Uh-huh.
A lot of policies, the difference between that coverage and not having that coverage gets down to a little asterisk on your your schedule of equipment. If that asterisk is there, there's coverage, and if it's not, there's none. You know, you either picked it or you didn't.
Right.
And so it's really easy to look at a policy and not, and if you're not reading the small print that's there, to just not even know if you have coverage for that foreign object and machinery.
Yep.
Risk.
Yeah, Jon Paul, I don't know if you probably know this, maybe a lot of listeners don't, that most insurance policies exclude damage done to equipment caused by a foreign object like a rock or steel post going through the combine or the baler.
Yeah.
And you have to add that coverage in either on the whole policy or item by item to get that. Anyway, that's one. That is actually one unique thing probably to a hay farm that, you know, other crops aren't as worried about.
My last nightmare, and then we'll switch to a slightly different topic here. Every bale wagon that I've ever owned has been on fire at some point. They have turbos. In the old days, they had gas engines that chaff accumulated. Every single one. I haven't burnt a bale. I've lost a swather, but I haven't lost a bale wagon yet. But it is my worst nightmare. Not to burn down the piece of equipment. Those things are replaceable. But to have field fires, and those happen like all the freaking time around me. What can I do?
On the claim side, there were a couple of things that we saw people do that would help minimize those issues. Keeping the equipment clean, even manufacturers sometimes on the balers they'll say to clean it daily. If you're baling dry, hot,
yep,
you know, dry material in hot environment, I mean, consider opening up those those panels and just making sure you don't have chaff or anything building up in there. Make sure you don't have hydraulic fluid leaking on your exhaust on those pieces of equipment. I mean, that's where most of our fires are coming from. We just get some material build up and it gets hot and mm-hmm. we get the fire.
I mean, I'm just thinking of engines and turbos on the bale wagons and yeah, all of those kind of things.
They have some devices that we see used in some instances now where you can mount it underneath the hood of your equipment. And if it senses a fire, it explodes with the fire pressing foam.
Mm-hmm.
Those probably aren't a bad idea, especially if you're in a very rural area and harvesting something that's exceptionally dry. Dryland wheat farmers, I mean, they light fires that are just unreal.
Oh, I mean, we can, we actually had an instance, this is me telling on myself, where just the skid plate on the swather header bounced over a rock, something that simple. And we had a small fire with extinguishers and those kind of things, but it's really easy.
Having a tractor with discs close by.
Yep.
I've seen where that's been the difference between hundreds of acres burnt and 2 or 3 acres that were lost.
Yep.
Multiple fire extinguishers. I can't count all the times that I've talked to people who they use their fire extinguisher up and then they sat and they watched the piece of equipment finish burning.
Yep.
And so having a spare on the piece of equipment or if you have multiple pieces of equipment, making sure you have radios or some way to to call for whoever else might be out there to come help put that out.
Is there a way to operationalize and document good policies and procedures? And I'll give you another example. We got to the end of July last year and we were baling some really, really dry grass. And the wind kicked up to 30 miles an hour and I just said, shut it down. If I had that in a written policy and procedure that we're not going to run hay equipment, you know, below 15% relative humidity, and we won't run with the wind over 20 miles an hour, is there a way to document that and get a reduction in rates?
All of our carriers, when we fill out the application, the question that's on the application is generally, do they have a safety program? Then they want to know some details about the safety program. So if you have that written out, and it should include, you know, those types of issues, cleanliness issues. Yep. It should talk about vehicle usage. At most agencies, we have a tool that we provide. Most agencies have something that they can bring to you as a grower to help you create those policies and mm-hmm. make sure your employees are trained.
Yeah. No, that's
so. It's a really big deal. If we can show an underwriter that there's a program in place and give them a copy of it,
mm-hmm.
it can solve a lot of problems. Because imagine you're an underwriter and you get this risk in and maybe let's say they've had a couple of recent claims that make it iffy.
Mm-hmm.
The underwriter's thinking about his or her job and how they're going to look. And they're thinking, okay, what if we write this policy and a year from now there's another big claim, which is no matter how good of a risk this is, that could happen. If they can go, so their boss comes in and says, what were you thinking? Why did you write this? And they go, well, look at all these things that this farmer was doing.
Yep.
It gives them a defense. But the challenge is, I think, that the smaller the farm, the fewer people are involved. And like you said, Jon Paul, like, can I write this down? I mean, yeah, you can, but why would you? You're like, I make all the decisions here. I know when it's too windy and I just won't do it.
So
you don't end up writing it down.
I really try to, one of my operational things is to give my employees autonomy to go and do their jobs because nobody likes a micromanager. But part of that is that training component. So I've almost committed myself completely to writing down the things that I am doing just to document it.
No, it's a great practice. I just think it's, the bigger the farm and with the more locations, they're kind of forced into developing written procedures because there's more people involved.
Yep.
And then the smaller it gets, it's just like, yeah, I'll get to that someday, but today I'm busy with this. But it is valuable from an insurance standpoint to have the policy and procedures, and then to also follow them. I mean, don't write it down if you're not willing to try to follow it.
Oh, no. No. In my case, that bail wagon gets blown off with a leaf blower on every single load. Just your heart rate only has to go up so many times before you get really dedicated to fire prevention. Again, my biggest nightmares. I have a proposition. Would you guys help me put together a starting point list that we could put up on the Hey Kings website and direct producers to get started with that process? And then we can brand it Hey Kings and Sloan Levitt.
Sure, we could help with that.
I just want to provide that resource to producers who might not have somebody that lives and works in the hay industry all the time, that they can take back to their insurance company and say, hey, I'm trying to do a good job. Here's a starting point for my policies and procedures.
Yeah, we can definitely help. I think if I can say just a couple of key things that I think insurance company that underwriters respond well to. One, in the hay business specifically, is what moisture level are we baling our hay at?
Yep.
And how are we
recording,
verifying
that,
it through the
it.
Process?
Yep.
Yeah. So that's one. And then the other one that's kind of to any farm is how are we screening our drivers that we're putting in our vehicles?
Mm-hmm.
That is a big deal. And it really just takes away the, if you're not screening your drivers and you end up with a bad accident and this guy happened to have, you know, he had 6 speeds and two accidents in the last 3 years.
Yep.
The attorney on the other side that's suing you is going to just beat you over the head with that. What you put my client in jeopardy by putting this person with this driving record that you either failed to check the record or you checked it and didn't care and you put the public in danger. Insurance companies, that drives them crazy. They love it when people say, I screen them. If they have more than X number of speeds or incidents, I don't hire them. And then I regularly review those driving records. Mm-hmm. They love it.
Hmm. Great feedback.
Another thing to consider is we have companies with GPS access trackers. You can put those in your vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
You can know if your vehicle was moving, how fast it was moving. We have the dash cams. Nathan and I were out visiting a customer who there's a fatality and a dash cam would have told whether that farm operation was liable or not. But without a camera, it's just word against word.
Right.
And so they're contesting that in court. But I guess the other story to tell is that Nathan has a customer who had a dash cam and there was a accident. There was some contested liability. And the footage on the dash cam really explained what happened without any doubt. And the policyholder was found to not be at fault.
Hmm.
So protect yourself.
Yeah.
There are tools and resources there. And another advantage in the GPS is one of your pieces of equipment gets stolen. Not a liability issue, but a first party issue. Makes it easier for the police to potentially recover that, where it's at.
All great pieces of advice there. Let's switch gears and talk about what hay farmers are experiencing in the insurance market. And I'm going to guess that rates are not dropping dramatically, even though hay prices might be.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I do think we've seen significant rate increases over the last 4 or 5 years. And the increases have really come from two things. Rates have definitely gone up, just the rate per thousand that they're charging for property values.
Yep.
But also property values have gone up. I mean, if they charge the same rate, but they're multiplying it by 10% higher limit, then you're experiencing a 10% increase in your premium.
Mm-hmm.
You're insuring more.
Yep.
So we've seen it on both sides. Definitely inflation. You could point to that as the main culprit. I mean, every claim costs more than it did, so they have to charge more rate. And the kind of the hidden side of it is the reinsurance market. Insurance companies are themselves buying insurance.
Yes.
And so those prices have gone up dramatically, and their retentions, the amount that, you know, the reinsurance companies may have before said, well, we'll attach it the first after 10 million in loss, and now they're at 20 million or 30 million. And so the insurance companies are having to retain more or pay a lot more money to insure those risks. And that's being passed down. And that, you know, you don't really see that as much, but that it's harder for us to intuitively understand why that's happening. But that is definitely a major cause of what's gone on in the market the last several years.
Mm-hmm.
It's not good, but with lower prices of hay, you are going to pay less for your hay insurance if you drop your limit. You know, if you had $1 million worth of hay that's only worth $800,000, you should see a premium decrease.
Yeah, that's true.
On that.
Yep. Now that's an update that you have to do. Like, how frequently is it realistic? Is it reasonable to update your stack values? Is this an annual thing?
Right
or
away.
Do we get to 2022? The fall of 2022 on the West Coast, when hay prices started just falling off the table, that's an opportunity to call up your insurance agent and say, hey, it's kind of realistic to reduce the value of this.
Absolutely. I mean, it's realistic to adjust your values more than annually. You're going to have a different value, a different quantity of hay stored in July than you are in February. And there are different strategies to accomplish that. So you don't have to do it by frequent phone calls to your agent, but you can. I mean, you could call your agent every 3 months and say, hey, I sold a bunch of hay. Can we reduce it from 400,000 to 250,000?
Yep.
I mean, you can do it fairly frequently.
Gotcha. I see in the notes here, cost of claims and frequency of claims. What are the trends there?
Over time, we've seen, especially with the advent of the internet, people are going online and they're finding out the most they can get out of an insurance company in a given cycle, both in liability claims and in property claims. 20 years ago, people might chat with their neighbors or friends and find out what they could ask for. Today, we're seeing people demand everything. Hmm. And that's increasing the cost of claims. And we have higher standards than we used to. If you look at the, you know, automotive repair standards, we've added airbags. Those are expensive systems. We have mandated that as soon as one airbag goes off, we replace most of the central computer components on that. So, and even a car accident that deploys one airbag can set you back $5,000 or $6,000 just replacing those computer and those other components. With houses, we've seen standards, which are a good thing, on cleaning up after water losses to make sure there's no mold damage or hazard to the people that are there. And that costs money. And then with bodily injury claims, we're seeing attorneys are more aggressive. People are seeking more expensive treatments more often on the bodily injury claim. So part of the premium increase is just our appetite for what we're expecting from the insurance companies when we have a claim as a community. And as far as frequency, this is something to just be aware of. Insurance companies, they don't like claims.
Right.
They need the claims in order to prove that they're providing a useful service, but they don't like claims that there's more and more and they're above average on the number of claims. My recommendation is if you can afford it, to look at raising your deductible. Mm-hmm. There's no need to turn in a claim for $1,000 or $2,000. For most people in their operation. So if you can afford a $2,500 claim or a $5,000 claim, put your deductible up that amount. You can afford a $10,000 claim. We see some people with deductibles at $25,000 or $50,000 now. And there's always the option that if you do have a you do have a claim halfway through the year and finances change and you really need to lower those deductibles because you couldn't afford a second loss, we can normally make a midterm policy change and lower those deductibles back down. Hmm. But insurance companies have a great name for these small claims. They call them nuisance claims.
Oh.
They're just the little ones that the cost of addressing the claim sometimes, you know, gets to be 25 or 50% of the amount that you're actually going to be able to pay out on the claim.
Right, right.
Do what you can to eliminate those. I mean, whether it's raising the deductible or just paying them or being more careful, all of those strategies should be employed.
Auto insurance and homeowners insurance and all sorts of agriculture is a really, really small portion of the global insurance market.
That's true.
Do ag producers pay more when there's a hurricane in maybe Florida is not the right answer because they got some screwy insurance rules. But if if there's a hurricane in Georgia or South Carolina or North Carolina, do hay producers in the Northwest pay more for that for their insurance because of that?
Go ahead, David.
I think it's important to know and understand that your farm policy is kind of the marriage of a commercial policy for a farming operation. And in a lot of cases, a homeowner's and a personal auto policy. Because you got mom and dad living on the farm with their kids. You got all their stuff in the house. You got the equipment and the farming operation out there. And so as far as being a complex policy, it's potentially one of the most complex operations that we insure because of all these moving parts.
It's not just a factory, and it's not just a car and a home. It's kind of everything all wrapped up.
So the actuaries are sitting there trying to figure out what are we going to charge to insure this home, and they're looking at the same data as the actuaries that are coming up with the rates for the homeowners policies that aren't attached to farm.
Mm-hmm.
And so they base a lot of that on zip code. And you know, we're up in Washington State. We're a long ways away from a hurricane. Chances are that our rates are not being negatively impacted by the presence of a hurricane in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some, I guess, secondary effects. If the hurricane in Florida increases the cost of building materials because they're all being used in Florida, then the cost of claims in Washington's likely going to go up a little bit, and we may see that indirectly.
I've been in meetings with insurance companies, and they've got the nation divided up by kind of territories,
mm-hmm.
and they may actually be trying to shift more into other regions to, you know, pick up more premium in the Northwest, both to diversify their book, you know, so they've got more spread of risk, and also because maybe there's areas that are more desirable than others. And the Northwest tends to be pretty desirable, you know, with the exception of the wildfire deal. But the reinsurance costs can be affected by natural disasters in other areas of the country. So when they're making their agreements to buy reinsurance, that's where it can bleed into, affecting us because the cost for them to buy reinsurance went up across the board because of that, at least in part because of the natural disaster somewhere else.
Let's talk about the services that you provide and how producers can get a hold of you guys.
I mean, we're a full service agency. We're definitely, our main focus is ag, mainly been what we've done. It's definitely our biggest industry. You know, we sell home, auto, farm, and business. We do life insurance. We also do, we have a good sized crop insurance department. I feel like we're easy to get a hold of. Just call us, right?
Yep. And again, that's Sloan Levitt Insurance. You're available to help people everywhere in the U.S.?
We are. We're not licensed in all states, but we can get licensed anywhere. And we do have policies probably in, I don't know, 25 different states. We're definitely concentrated in the North Washington, being the biggest state, and Oregon and Idaho would be the next two.
Gotcha. And then on the crop insurance side, there you are available to help folks all across the U.S., right?
We are. Yeah, we can.
thank you both. Again, I've been joined by Nathan Beus and David Cannon to have a good discussion about the things that hay farmers need to know about insurance. If you'd like more information, go ahead and search for Sloan Levitt Insurance if you're in the Northwest. And if you're anywhere in the U.S., you can also reach out to them for crop insurance.